Hello, coffee drinkers. I'm out in Hollywood going to make the police report for the stolen bass and all the stolen gear yesterday. Never done this before. Asked the advice of a few different people. They said it's better to go do it in person than to call it in. So here I am, Los Angeles Police Department, Hollywood Station.
Never be forgiving, you know? And we're not trying to tell them, what are you doing to people? They took me to the hospital and they handcuffed me to district my 24-hour freezing, you know?
Okay, couldn't make a police report. They actually have to come out and investigate, which is actually, I guess that's a good thing, that they actually taking some interest in it. I find out that this particular storage unit, the company is Extra Space Storage, by the way. I shouldn't be keeping that a secret. I should be really letting people know that, A, it's a disaster. If you don't follow Brian Bella, please follow Brian Bella. The same thing happened to Brian about 4 months ago. He's obviously way farther into the process than I am. And I spoke to him on the phone this morning. But if you don't know Brian Bella, you must know Brian Bella. He's an awesome bass player. And unfortunately, this happened to him and somebody knocked over like 7 of his basses and a ton of gear. Anyway, I got to talk to him this morning. He was awesome and gave me so much great advice and information. Hence the reason I'm here making the police report. And you know, we both were of the same opinion that just, storage is not it for musicians anymore. Like, you just can't rely on that stuff. He made a great point of this show, this Storage Wars show that's on TV over here in the US. It basically, how did he put it? He put it like it's storage units are like banks, are like the new banks, except nobody's keeping an eye on it. There's no security. So yeah, the story continues. Apparently tomorrow morning, 7 a.m., I'm going to be going out there with the police and check into it all, and we'll see what happens. Actually a little bit more hopeful, even just from the interest that the police are taking in it. And I thought it was just going to be a report and just filed away, but the guy was actually really nice and he said, yeah, this storage unit has been uncooperative for years and they're a bunch of crooks. And so we might actually be able to do something about this. Obviously still sad about losing the stuff, but there's nothing I can do about that right now. I think I'm doing everything I can. The police are apparently gonna try and do everything they can, which is really nice. And all the outpouring of support, that's awesome, guys, and the comments, and that's so great. And thank you to Brian and for Damien Erskine. There were a bunch of people who shared the post, and hopefully we can share it enough. And I will get a list of the stuff as well. I'll see if I can find some photographs of everything. Maybe I have photographs in the archive somewhere of everything that got stolen. Hopefully I do, and I can post that on Facebook, like a whole inventory of what got taken, and people can just be on the lookout. I have much faith in humanity and in you guys, and like Brian Bella said, these fools don't know who they're knocking over. Me and Brian are not exactly invisible online. We have quite the social media presence, and you know, Brian's a super nice guy. I try to be a nice guy and pay everything forward. It's just crappy things happening to good people, and that happens all over the world. I mean, this is quite insignificant in terms of the level of crappy, you know, what happened to me and Brian. We got some stuff stolen. Nobody died or anything. Nobody got hurt, but it is a bummer, and it's not nice. You know, it's just not great for people to have that mentality, to think that that's okay and that they're going to get away with it and that there won't be any consequences. So not such a bad day today, like a good follow up, and actually kind of put my mind at rest a little bit. And I got my gym in today before going to the police station. So not so bad. Now it's time to do some serious practice and really work on getting the chops in shape for the tour, which is 6 days away. So how do you get massive chops, right? That's the title of today's vlog. I wanted to make kind of an example of what
technique is, what chops are, and how kind of unimportant I think the whole thing is in terms of a concept. Like, so many people are overawed by what they deem to be impressive technique. You know, YouTube is just like completely jam-packed solid with shredding and fast stuff and high stuff and loud stuff and that whole like impressive chops thing. Maybe a little bit of overplaying, but I don't even think that really comes into it that much, because I think it's the kind of the intent behind the playing and behind the music that really gives it that veneer, that kind of identity of, oh, this is impressive. Now, to me, technique and chops, or whatever you want to call it, whatever label you have for it, is all about being able to execute a musical idea. It's got nothing to do with speed. Kind of, I'll get to that in a second. But really, it's got nothing to do with, I should say, maybe not speed, but who can play the fastest, like any of those kind of, when music becomes competitive, I guess that's what I'm trying to say. As soon as competition comes into music, you've kind of lost the entire plot of what it's all about, I think. So, great technique, chops, huge chops, all that ability and facility and all of those kind of things. It's all about being able to execute that musical idea that you're having, not being competitive with another musician or to impress an audience in terms of just simply playing fast. Now, are you gonna have at some point some incredibly fast and complicated musical idea? Perhaps. Now, if you can't execute that idea, that is the point when I say that perhaps you don't have great technique, when the idea doesn't completely flow out of you and onto your instrument and into the listener's ear. So, as impressive as all of that kind of stuff, or as impressive as it may seem, I think it's kind of jive, to be honest. That's where I'm coming from. Yes, I do play things that are fast, but I do have like some complicated, complex musical ideas that I want to execute in the context of a composition or an improvisation or a melody or whatever it might be, a performance, shall we say. And I don't know why today I was working on that four finger technique. I literally sat down on the back of the couch, actually. I also don't know why I was up there, so it's a bit of a weird day all around. But I just wanted to pick one note to warm up with, and I wanted to warm up my right hand. So okay, let me use all the digits, my thumb and my first three fingers on the right hand to warm up. And then I remember, oh yeah, I was really impressed by people who could do this like 15 or 20 years ago, and all I wanted to do was literally play that fast. And you know, I was at some point, of course, a young musician impressed by exactly the same things I'm saying aren't that impressive now. This is just old age speaking, I think. But it's also a development and a musicality, I think, that comes out of most musicians when they reach a certain point where they realize that technique really isn't everything, and that it would, you know, probably better serve them, me, you, us, everyone, if we developed our technique to go along with the intent and context of our music. So, I guess it was nice to know I still had that facility in case I ever wanted to perform a musical idea like that. I do sometimes play more like a classical guitar tremolo thing when I'm playing chords. I do some things like that sometimes. I don't really play lines with it. I don't play linear ideas with that four finger technique. I think it actually sounds kind of a little clumsy and just a little bit too much. A little bit like it's done just for effect, and that effect is to impress people rather than to be musical. That's my take on it. So it doesn't creep into my playing in terms of playing lines. But sometimes when I'm creating like tension and creating kind of a wall of sound, be really useful to thicken up the sound. But anyway, regardless of any of that, it was nice to know that it still existed in my technique. I kind of happened upon it. I hadn't played it in years and years and years, and it got me thinking about, you know, what are chops, what is technique, and how do you get better at all of them. I think the first thing you have to do to get better at all of them is to stop thinking about it as technique and stop thinking about it as chops, and definitely get rid of any kind of competitive element you have in your music or your practice routine or your intent when it comes to performing or when it comes to practicing, of course. And then, you know, I did that for maybe 30 seconds, maybe a minute, but then I went right back into like, what is it that I need right now? You know, what is it that my performance is when I go on the road in a week's time? What are they gonna need? What do I need to feel good about my practice time now? Those are all things that I think go into the process of creating better technique. And the bulk of my playing today has been thinking about perfect form. I mean, I don't know if you've ever been in the gym and people have been doing curls, or they've been doing like tricep pull downs, you know, with the two pieces of rope like this. And you can kind of tell when they have poor form. You know, if they're doing the pull downs for the triceps, the elbows are swinging up and it's like this motion instead of the elbows staying by the side. Just whatever it is, doing bicep curls or doing lunges or squats or whatever it is, always the main focus I've always felt in the gym or exercising has been to have as close to perfect form as possible. And that has always been true with my practicing with the instrument as well. From when I used to play classical guitar, it was very rigid then. It was quite very specific. I really appreciate those years of practicing classical guitar and doing so many exercises that were quite structured, and the posture had to be right, and I used a footstool and my guitar was on my left knee and all of those things. It was very, very proper, if you like, as so much classical music is. And that kind of translates into what I do now, into the gym, into anything, no matter what it is, just walking even, to have a good gait when you walk, to walk well so you're not like all lopsided. I'm always thinking about perfect form. Now, when I'm practicing something simple, like two octave minor major arpeggios, for instance, which I was doing today, that's why I bring it up. I was doing that right before I switched the camera on. So immediately I take that big breath out. So I'm relaxed. And I'm paying attention to my whole body here, to everything that's working, to my right hand, to my left hand, the placement of my shoulder, where my elbows are, both of them, you know, is my left elbow tucked in under here? Is it way out there? Where's my thumb? Like, I'm paying attention to all the details so I can get as close to perfect form as possible. I'm also not playing screamingly fast, even if I'm working on improving my tempo with a certain idea. The very first thing I do when I want to improve speed or tempo with a certain idea is to go way slow. It's to take the metronome down to 45 or 50 and get way, way down there in terms of the tempo. Right now, I've been practicing for about 2 or 3 hours, so my tempo is kind of medium right now, I would say. Everything's pretty even, each note is it. These are the things I'm paying attention to. These are the things, if you want to improve any element of your technique and your ability to execute when you have musical ideas, these are the things, I think at least, that you should really be paying attention to. And it's really easy to overlook it. If you're not disciplined and you're not focused when you sit down to practice, it's super easy for these things to get overlooked. And you can suddenly be like, okay, the wrist is bent and the elbow's all over the place and the shoulder's up and is tense and all of these things. Very, very easy. Don't get me wrong. I understand that it is very easy to overlook those things and to suddenly be completely contorted and not be relaxed at all. So that's why I'm here. That's why the vlog is here, to help remind you, take a nice deep breath. Be very relaxed when you're playing. Think about your posture. Think about your surroundings. Think about all those things. It's those things that are going to help your technique improve when you practice the right things at a slower tempo. It might sound kind of boring. I know you want to like pick up the instrument and fly around it sometimes. Hey, I do too sometimes. Don't get me wrong. I'm not some Zen Buddhist monk here who just and everything flows. Not at all. I can be a knucklehead too. I can pick up the instrument and be like lying down on the couch and watching TV and playing with horrible technique. And sometimes that is my 15-minute practice routine. But when I see improvement in my playing, it is always having followed a really focused and dedicated period of practice. Now, I'm leaving on the road in, you know, 6 days. I could not be more focused and more dedicated to it right now. Because when I hit the stage in Istanbul on May 7th for the first show of this European leg of the tour, I want to make it you know, I want that performance to sound like I've already done 10 shows and I'm completely warmed up and I'm completely in the zone. Like, that's my goal right here. That is the intent with which I am practicing. So I can't recommend that enough, that you really, you find your peace, you find your center, and you really try and find your flow as quickly as possible, and just be focused and concentrated on those little details. I would hazard a guess and say that no matter what level you're at as a musician, you are more aware of your own body than you are of your instrument or of your music. So that's really easy then to check off those first few boxes of like, how do you feel? Do you feel relaxed? Do you feel, you know, are you breathing well? Is your posture good? You know, does everything feel okay? Do all your limbs feel okay? Like, those first things, forget the instrument, you know? Instrument is secondary. The music can be third, if you like, if you have like a little checklist. Checklist number one is, do you feel good? Do you feel like you want to practice? And are you focused? And do you have the time and the space to dedicate some time to doing it? That's super important. So if you've got that first thing checked, great. Grab the instrument and pick an exercise, you know, pick something to warm up. I really like to vary the warm up as much as possible. I often play diminished chords, or any four note chord, because that gets the left hand and the right hand, all eight digits, left and right hands, moving. And through that, I'm talking to you right now, so my level of stress and relaxation is not probably where it should be, because I'm trying to do many things at the same time. But if you can really be in a peaceful place, doing something simple like this really sets you up to get some stuff done. And I always talk about this: if you only have 15 or 20 minutes a day, 30, or let's say 1 minute of your 20 minutes can be spent warming up like that, and then you're gonna be so productive. If you've checked all those things on the list, that you're in the right place, you have the right intent, you have the right focus, and you've dedicated that 20 minutes, even if it's only 20 minutes, you do that 1 minute of preparation with the instrument when you start, and then you're gonna be so much more productive in that next 19 minutes than you would have done if you'd just like rushed into it without having any kind of plan. You don't necessarily have to have a plan, I don't think, for the notes you're going to play, unless there's something particularly deficient in your playing that you know you really want to work on. You can totally let it happen naturally. I do that most of the time. I'm really not trying to preempt the ideas I'm gonna play on the tour. I want those to come naturally. So what I'm doing right now is laying the foundation. A relaxed and focused practice so that I give myself the best chance of success and of executing those ideas efficiently when I get out on the stage. Like I said, May 7th, Istanbul, that's my big focus right now. Of course, the bigger picture is the entire tour, but I'm just heading towards that day, towards that show. I couldn't be more excited. So that's an amazing place to be coming from with that. Like, I'm so inspired, I'm so excited, I'm so motivated to practice. So you wanna find those things, whether it's a show coming up or rehearsal or recording session, or whether you're just like psyched and you're high on life and you just wanna practice and play music, whatever it is, find that thing and really focus in on it. It's those details. It's everything I've talked about in the last, 10 or 12 minutes that is going to improve your technique. At least it has for me, and I can pretty much guarantee if you follow those simple steps, it will help for you as well. Please don't forget to check out the Last Minute World Tour dates below in the description of this video. I really hope I'm coming to a city near you. If I'm not, send me an email at the website and let's try and make that happen. I'm doing a second European leg in June, then we've got US dates in July, a couple in August, then Asia, then New Zealand and Australia, and then back to South America. It's non-stop for the rest of the year. So please stay in touch with that. Follow along on Instagram and on Facebook. Make sure you're on my mailing list. Make sure we are completely connected so you don't miss anything. I think that's the end of the public service announcement. Yeah, it is. Okay, and that means today's vlog is over. I will have more updates from the police and that whole investigation that's gonna happen early tomorrow morning. But yes, today's vlog is over and I will see you guys tomorrow. Thank you.